Attention is closely related to working memory, and it's possible to take our N2PC attention paradigm and modify it to see an ERP component related to working memory called contralateral delay activity, or CDA. In this task, subjects are asked to remember the colors of the circles and ignore the rectangles. They only have to remember the colors for about a second, and then they see a test array. They then indicate whether the colors of any of the circles have changed. In this example, the red circle changed to blue. The rectangles never change color. In this kind of paradigm, you initially see an N2PC component as attention is shifted to the circles. This is followed by the CDA, or contralateral delay activity, a sustained voltage over the hemisphere contralateral to the objects being maintained in memory. The N2PC and CDA are added on to other components, but you can isolate them by looking at the difference between the contralateral and ipsilateral waveforms. Although they're both contralateral negativities, the N2PC and CDA have different scalp distributions, so they're distinct components. The N2PC reflects the initial focusing of attention onto a visible stimulus, and the CDA represents the maintenance of information in working memory after the stimulus has disappeared. One of the coolest things about the CDA is that it's strongly correlated with individual differences in behaviorally measured working memory capacity. It's not often that you can see such a strong correlation between brain activity and individual differences in cognitive ability. If you'd like to know more about ERP components related to attention and working memory, I recommend these three chapters in the Oxford Handbook of ERP Components. Here's an amazing new direction in studying attention and working memory with ERPs. We can use machine learning algorithms to decode the contents of working memory on the basis of the pattern of voltage over the scalp. For example, in this study, Guil Bay presented a series of faces drawn from a set of 16 combinations of 4 identities and 4 expressions. Subjects simply had to remember the most recent face, and their memory was tested after a random 12% of faces. Guil then trained a set of support vector machines to classify the identity of the face independently of the expression. He trained another set of support vector machines to classify the expression independently of the identity. The ERP scalp distributions differ only slightly among the 4 identities and 4 faces, but the support vector machines could pull out these subtle differences. As a result, decoding accuracy was well above chance, 25%, for both identity and expression. Moreover, the decoding was done separately at each time point so that Guil could determine what information was present in the signal at each moment in time, first during the stimulus and then during the delay period. Although the decoding was more accurate when the stimulus was visible, information about both identity and expression could be decoded from working memory after the face disappeared. Pretty amazing, huh? It's especially amazing given that Guil was recording brain activity from electrodes on the skin outside of the skull. The decoding accuracy never got above around 40% correct, and the decoding was done on average ERPs rather than single trials. So, the scalp signal doesn't have enough information about faces to be used for engineering applications like brain-computer interfaces. We can't realistically use this approach to read your mind, but maybe that's a good thing.